Hello everyone, this is Nandeep from MyDAS India. In this session, I'll give a brief introduction to how TMH7 has been implemented in MyDAS Civil. So this would be the flow of today's presentation. First of all, the provisions which have been implemented in MyDAS Civil, then we'll go for a brief software demonstration wherein I'll give an idea of what all features the software has in brief, and we'll generate a model, then we'll apply the moving load to that and we'll see what sort of results we can obtain and what would be the different vehicle positions. So first of all, the provisions. The vehicles which have been considered in MyDAS Civil in accordance to TMH7 are any vehicle. So this any vehicle has two parts. One is nominal distributed lane load, the other is nominal axle load or knife edge load. Now the nominal distributed lane load, it follows a specific function which is 180 by root of length to be loaded and plus 6 to that. So the length which is loaded by this nominal load, it is incremented in accordance to user preference. So user could, you know, give an input as to how much this load is to be incremented at once. So initial 36 meters would be loaded with obviously 36 kilonewton per meter. Then the user can select whether the next 2 meters should be loaded or next 1 meter should be loaded. 4 meters should be loaded. It's user choice, and based on that, the analysis speed would vary. But the next loaded increment, it would be loaded such that the average distributed load will follow this curve. Knife edge load also, it will follow the formulation as given in TMH7, and it would be placed at the most critical position for the element which is being checked. The next vehicle considered is ND vehicle. So for ND vehicle, the wheel spacing is 3 meters. There are total 4 wheels in transverse direction. ND vehicle, there is only one vehicle possible per carriageway in accordance to standard. The axle spacing could be varying, which might cause the worst effect. So as you can see, the X which is in the center part, that could be 6, 11, 16, 21 or 26, and this is a unit NB vehicle. So NB 24 and NB 36 are available as of now. The third vehicle is NC vehicle. So again, in accordance to standard, the A, B and C values are provided, wherein the blue part is the loaded area with the intensity of 30 kilonewton per meter square. So again, A, B and C would be in accordance to the provisions of the standard. So these are our standard vehicles. Besides this, you can also give user defined vehicles. So as I said, for say example, NB vehicle. So NB 24 and NB 36 is available, but if you want to change the unit instead of 36, maybe say 40, some client is providing a specific requirement for that, then you could go for a user defined NB vehicle. Similarly for NC, you could change the dimensions as well as the load intensity. Besides this, you could also define a permit truck. So if there is a very special vehicle, then that can also be done. User also has the provision for say NC vehicle, whether he wants to consider the area giving relieving effect or not. As you already know, for NA and ND vehicle, the loading which gives the relieving effect is to be ignored. But for NC vehicle, that is not the case, and it's a user choice whether they want to consider the relieving effect or not. Now, the load cases. So, simple ones first of all. So, either all the lanes are loaded with any type of vehicle, any single lane is loaded with just ND vehicle, or any single lane is loaded with NC vehicle. Now the standard mentions that a single carriageway is to be loaded with only a single type of vehicle, so that makes the load combination generation quite easy. But it clearly mentions that if there's a dual carriageway system, then the load combination to be considered is also one carriage way loaded with NC vehicle and the other carriage way loaded with two-thirds of total NA load. So dual carriageway system for a bridge as shown on image to the left bottom. For that, this particular load combination can also be generated. Besides that, another option is for user-defined moving load case generation. Consider the bridge on the right bottom. So you see there are different Y spans. So what kind of vehicle load combination you want to consider for this type of bridge? If you want to do that, then that can be done in user-defined moving load case. Now, moving load optimization. So there are two ways in which this can be done in Midas Civil. One is regular optimization. So in this method, what is done is once the user defines a lane, the vehicle is placed on the extreme left of the lane, at the center of the lane, and extreme right of the lane. So for a single lane, these three positions would be checked for the vehicle. So if we are talking about NA load, or say for example NC load, for which the transverse placement will not have very significant effect, you can go for regular optimization. Now when I say it won't have very significant effect, I mean, say for example the lane width is 3 meters, the NA placement, whether it is in center, left or right, these three positions of NA vehicle would be sufficient to gauge the worst effect. But if I talk about NB vehicle, which is only a single vehicle on the carriageway and could be placed anywhere in transverse direction, this type of optimization won't be sufficient. Why? For NB vehicle, we will go for multipoint such that the optimization width would be the entire carriageway width. We will leave certain margin from the crash barrier as provided in the code. Then we know what is the lane width, we know what is the vehicle width, and we can give the analysis lane offset. So in this way, for a 9 meter carriageway width, if you want to check for NB vehicle position and say 1 meter transverse direction offsets, then that can be done quite easily using the multipoint optimization. Okay, so that was just on what things are taken up in Civil. Now I'll just give you a brief demonstration of the software. So once you start Midas Civil, this is the window that you will see. First of all, at the top, the ribbon menu. The arrangement of this menu is such that you could simply go from left to right and use all the available options to generate your model. So first of all, one would set the viewing options as to, and say for example, display what sort of color series you should be working with. If it is black, they could go to display options, and say set background to black. So they could work with that. So these are simple your display options which you could set up before starting out with the model. Then the structure tab. So this is the most basic tab that one has to set up before proceeding. So say for structure type, whether it is 3D structure or whether it's a planar structure, if you are considering eigenvalue analysis, so whether you are considering lumped mass or consistent mass, what is the system temperature, so those kind of options could be set in structure type. Then for quick model generation, we have the wizards available over here. So if you are generating any say suspension bridge, for example, so you could click on suspension bridge, and this is the wizard input. So these wizards help in setting you out with the model generation. Your suspension bridge would have multiple hangers and pylons and all those things. So you could set up a single dimension model over here, which could be translated on either direction to generate your complete 3D model. Similarly, there are options for cable state bridge, so you can set it up. These wizards are mainly for setting up your model with the construction stages. Then there is rail track analysis. So if you are into metro structures or long welded rail structures and you want to analyze the effect of deck temperature and rail temperature or different train positions on your structure, then in that case you can go for this rail track analysis. So you need to use this tab for quick model generation. If you want to generate the model the old fashioned way, everything manually, then the options for your different node and element generation are provided in the nodes and elements tab. Then you define the properties, so material properties, your time dependent properties, section properties, and so on. Then the boundaries, so whether it is fixed support or you want to go for springs, or the software can even auto generate the springs based on the soil properties. So if you go to integral bridge option, then whether it's abutment spring or pile spring, so it will generate multilinear springs based on the input provided over here. Then there are links to generate your bearings and other restraining conditions. Then the different loads, so your static loads, simple element loads, pressure load, hydrostatic pressure, then temperature, that is uniform temperature or temperature gradient, then the pre-stress loads, so all of that can be done from here. Dynamic load, the time history load, response spectrum loads, then the construction stages. We won't go into much detail of this right now as it would be quite time consuming. Besides that, we have settlement, and if at all you are into it, so wave loads, and the one that we are going to discuss the most today, the moving load. Okay, then under analysis, we have the analysis control options. So if you have something very specific to look into, like say for example, if I click on moving load, so for a plate, say if you want even stresses and concurrent forces, so you can select that. If you want results only for a specific group and not the entire structure, then you can select that as well. Similarly, there are options for other features. Then simple result interpretation, your stresses, reactions, beam bending moments, your load combinations. Yes, the important thing is in Midas Civil, the load combinations can be generated after the model has been analyzed. Okay, so you do not need to reanalyze the model to check the result with the load combination. The moment you generate the load combination, instantly the result for the combination would be available. Then the different design and advanced analysis options. Okay, so that was the ribbon menu. Then just below the ribbon menu is a quick access tab. So for the functions which you will access on a regular basis, like your different selection options and your view options, so those could be accessed from over here. Similarly, the menu is there on the right. Then on the left is the tree menu. So anything that you do in the model would be instantly updated in this tree menu, and it is interactive with the work window that you see. We'll use this while generating the model. While you are executing any command, if there is any error message, then that would be available here in the command message window. And while performing the analysis, this is not a black box, so you will be able to see how your analysis is progressing, whether there is convergence or not. All of that would be available over here. If there is any warning, then that could be checked from over here. And finally, you can say whether the analysis is successful or not. So that is the command message and analysis message window. And at the bottom over here are your unit changes. So you could change the unit anytime in the flow of modeling. Okay, so let's begin with the modeling. For now, let us say we'll go for the old method. We'll generate the model manually. So I'll go to nodes and elements, create node. So I'll just create a node at the origin. Okay, so one node has been generated over here. You see my mouse is stuck over there. What I'll do is now I'll extrude this node to generate my line element. So I'll click on extrude. I'll select the node. And I want to extrude it for the same distance multiple times. So say in global X direction, I want to extrude it for 1 meter 50 times. So a 50 meter span of bridge would be generated. Apply. Okay, so a 50 meter long line has been created with multiple nodes. Now let us say that's it for geometry right now. Let's keep it simple. Let's go to properties. Material properties. You see over here in the tree menu, once I created the elements and nodes, so nodes 51, elements 50, and the material property and the section property, I have not defined it right now, so that's why it is red in color. Okay, so let me define a material property, add. So there are four different types of materials which could be used in Midas: steel, concrete, SRC, that is your steel and RC composite section, and user defined. So if it's completely user defined, you can give even orthotropic properties for that. So let us keep it isotropic for now, and we'll go for concrete. So Eurocode, and these are the database standards. If you want to go for your own material, then you can set this to none and you could give the material properties you want. Okay, so I've defined the material property. You see, now this is C4050. Similarly, I'll add a section. So if I click on section properties over here, add. So there are many different types of sections which you could define over here in MIDAS. Your simple I section, channel section, box sections, and so on. Similarly, say for example, if you do not have the exact section dimensions, but you want to directly enter the values, then you could define that under the value tab, general section. Or if you have some section for which you want to edit the sectional properties for say certain dummy section, then that kind of section can also be defined under the value tab. Then there's a tab for SRC sections, combined sections, PSC sections, so different one cell, two cell, different kinds of box sections as well as I sections could be generated over here. Tapered section, so tapered could be any sort of section you could select and it would be available. Similarly, composite sections, steel as well as PSC composite sections and steel girders. So right now, to save on time, I won't be defining all the section properties. I'll simply import it. Okay, so these are different section properties. Okay, and the moment I import it, the first section property would be assigned to it. You see, remaining section properties are blue in color. This means they have been defined, but they have not been assigned anywhere in the model so far. Let us simply define a boundary. Define support. So the very first support will keep it fully restrained, except the moment. We'll keep the moment free. Apply. And then I'll define a support at center, which would just be vertical direction support. And similarly at the end. Okay, so this is right now I'm not going much into the actual support positions. Actually, they should be defined at the bearing position, but for now what we are concerned is just the way moving load is applied. So I have defined the support directly at the top location. And though in reality it looks a 3D structure like this, but what we have modeled is nothing but a simple line like this. Okay. So let us quickly move to the load application. Under moving load, I can select South Africa over here. Okay. Then traffic line lanes. So there are two options. One is line lane, another is moving load optimization. So for NA and NC, we need to use traffic line lanes, and for NB, we can use moving load optimization. So I'll define the lanes for NA, say NA1, lane width. I'll just give a brief on the section that we have used over here. The total width of the section is 10 meter. And I'm assuming 0.5 carriageway on both the sides. So total, 0.5 crash barrier on both the sides. So total carriageway width would be 9 meter. So for NA, single lane width would be 3 meters. That would be 3 lanes for NA. Wheel spacing. This wheel spacing is more of an influence line generation point. So in MIDAS, we consider 4 locations or 4 lines for generating the influence point. So any vehicle has a width of 1.9 meters. So over here you need to enter 1.9 by 3. So typically this wheel spacing always has to be your vehicle width by 3. Okay, so NA1. Eccentricity is with respect to your reference point. So in this case, through center. So for first lane, I am taking it downward direction. So eccentricity, I am putting, say, -4.5 meter. So in this case, it would be -3 meter. Why? My one lane would be exactly at the center. One lane would be 3 meter off the center. 3 meter means center line of my extreme left lane. Similarly, -3 for extreme right lane. So let us just do that. -3. And we'll go for traffic lane optimization. So as I said, 3 positions would be checked for this particular load. And 2 points. So The first point and the last point. And you see the dialog box is quite big, it's going out of the screen. So for these kind of dialog box, there is a small minimize button provided in the window itself. So you could click on that and apply. So one lane has been defined. Okay. Similarly, another lane, so NA2, the eccentricity would be 0. I'll just delete this and again I'll click on first point and last point. And similarly, NA3. So now the eccentricity would be 3. Delete these. And okay. Okay, so three lanes for NA vehicle have been defined. Similarly, now I'll define one lane for NC vehicle. So add NC. Now in NC vehicle, the code specifies that it has to run along the center line of the carriageway with an offset of about 1 meter on either side. So if we are considering a 5 meter width of the vehicle, then the lane width has to be 7 meters. Eccentricity would obviously be zero in this case. Wheel spacing, so as I said, we are considering a 5 meter wide vehicle, so this would be 5 by 3. We'll go for traffic lane optimization. First point to last point, minimize this and okay. So NC lane has been defined and NB lane would be under moving load optimization. Add, so NB. Optimization lane, I am considering currently the complete carriageway, so this would be 9 meter. Lane width is actually just 3 meter. Analysis lane offset 1 meter, so that 3 meter would be shifted by 1 meter each in transverse direction to check the worst positioning. Wheel spacing for NB vehicle is 1 meter. Margin I am keeping 0 right now and eccentricity is 0 as well. So I'll click on first point to last point and okay. Okay, so I have defined the lanes required for my moving load. If I'm using a plate model, then in that case you need to use this traffic surface lane option. Since we are using a line model, we are using the traffic line lane options. Now the vehicles at standard. Okay, so since I've selected South Africa, the standard is TMH7 and the vehicle available are NA, NB and NC. So for NA vehicle, you can see it's the load is in accordance to standard. Unit length for load increment. So how much length of load increment you want with each moving the load position so that you can select over here. So for now, let us say we'll keep this at 2 meter. Similarly, we can add NB. So this is constant number of units 36 or 24. So that would make it your NB 36 or 24. So let us make this NB 36. Okay. And similarly, NC vehicle. So these are the different A, B, and C which would be considered. And here is the option whether we have to consider the load area giving the relieving effect or the opposite effect or not. Okay. So you can select that. Besides this, if you have user-defined vehicles, as I had mentioned, add user-defined. So type NA. You can change all the parameters for the load which you want to consider. Similarly, you can change the parameters for your NB and NC as well. If you want to increase the number of A's or B's, you can do that as well. And finally, the permit truck. So if it's a very special vehicle that needs to be considered, then that can be defined over here in the permit truck. Okay, then the moving load cases add. Say, first of all, for NA cases, so this is not going to be moving load optimization, that only has to be selected for NB. So for NA, I'll select all the three lanes, apply. So NA cases is here, similarly, NC, so I'll select NC. And in this case, there is only NC lane. You notice the vehicle over here, it has automatically changed to NC the moment I selected the type NC load model. So this is NC, apply, and now I'll come to moving load optimization. So this is to be selected for type NB vehicle. So NB36 is the vehicle and loaded lane is also NB. So I'll change the name to NB cases and okay. Okay, so the moving load cases are done. Now let us just save this model. And let us perform the analysis. So you see, the moment the analysis starts, the analysis progress and what stage exactly the analysis is on would be shown in the analysis message window in the detail. Okay, so it took about 20 seconds for this analysis. Now let us see the results, and right now I'll purely concentrate on the moving load tracer features, which tells me what is the vehicle position causing the worst effect. So I'll just display the boundaries so that we get an idea. Support. Okay, now let us check. So moving load tracer, first of all I want to check for the beam forces and moment at the mid of the span. So here you notice the cases are for NA, NC and NB as we have defined, for maximum as well as minimum. So what Midas Civil gives us is directly the envelope for the moving load cases. So if I say MV max, the key element which is say over here, and MY, that is the bending moment, and if I say apply, I'll just disable the value for now. Okay, so this is my NA vehicle. As you can notice, the increment or the change in load value is happening by a length of 2 meter. I had created each element of 1 meter length. As you can see, 2 meter is changing because for NA, I had defined the unit length for load increment as 2 meters. Okay, now let me activate the value once. And I'll change the unit to kilonewton. So you see, the moment I change it, instantly the result would be available with the new unit. So now, as I mentioned, Midas Civil considers 4 influence line points per traffic lane definition. So that is why 4 locations have been loaded with UDL of 9 kilonewton per meter, which brings it to 36 kilonewton per meter for one particular NA vehicle. Again, I'll disable the values, otherwise it would be a bit confusing. And these vehicle would be placed along the influence line points. Okay, so causing the worst effect. So this was NA positioning for maximum bending at the center. Similarly, you can check for minimum, that is negative bending at the support location. You can view the legend to give you an idea of what the magnitude is. So different knife edge loads along with the UDL would be provided in accordance to critical positioning. Similarly, you can check for reactions. So at the very first node. Okay. So what is the knife edge load to be provided? So this is the upward reaction. If I say maximum downward, so that would bring it to this. Okay, so these are different NA vehicle positions for reactions and bending. You can get the value over here as well as from the legend. Similarly, you can check for NB. So if we check again bending, beam forces and moments for MV max NB, key element somewhere in the center, and apply. So this is the NB vehicle which causes the maximum sagging moment at the center. Similarly, if I want to check for hogging, so right now you notice the NB vehicle is the axles are quite closely placed, but if I check at the mid support location, so the distance between my NB vehicle is high. This is in accordance to the X value, which is to be provided for the central part. Similarly, NC load. So if I say MV min NC, so these are the loaded parts to be considered for worst negative bending moment at the central location. Okay, so A, B, and C are selected accordingly, and the total UDL is about 37.5 kN per meter, which brings out a total loading intensity of 30 kN per meter square for 5 meter loaded width. Okay, so this is how you can check the results. Now, similarly, I'll show one another model. Since we don't have time, I won't be able to generate a dual model. So in reality, if we have a dual carriageway model like this, okay, then the code suggests that one part should be loaded with NA and other part should be loaded with NC. So that option could be set up from over here under moving load cases. Okay, so if you select this option, you can select which are your NC lanes and which are your NA lanes. So all the NA lanes would be loaded, whereas only any one critical NC lane would be loaded. If you have defined multiple lanes, say you want to consider multiple positions due to some case as suggested by the client, then you can define multiple lanes. But since the standard says that only one lane could be loaded with NC vehicle per carriageway, so only one of these lanes would be loaded at once. Okay, so you can define the load case when one carriageway is loaded with NA and other with NC. Similarly, you can define another case for interchanging the carriageway loads, and you could check the results for that in this model. Okay, let's try to perform the analysis of this. In this model, as you can notice, the bearings have been placed over here. So I'll just display the boundary conditions a bit to explain. Okay, so this is the top node. From here, the forces would be transferred. That is, forces would be transferred from section top to section bottom. Now over here, an elastic link is provided, which would be representing your bearings. So if it's a guided bearing, then it's different stiffnesses, your translational as well as the rotational stiffnesses could be provided, and a fixed support is provided at the bottom of the different piers. Instead of this, if you want to consider a substructure wherein you have created the pile cap, the piles, then that can also be done. As for this model, the carriageways, as you can notice, there is a clear gap in between the carriageways. There is no direct force transfer over here, but the substructure for both the carriageways is common, and hence the clause as suggested in TMH7 comes into play for NA and NC load over here. Now here I have only considered a single span. If you want to consider multiple spans, then that can also be done. Also, even for the sections, what I have considered is a section of same depth and same geometry all throughout. But if you want to consider tapered sections or diaphragm sections at the ends, then that can also be done. Okay. In the last model, we had checked the moving load tracer feature. Besides that, if you want to check loads simply, then that can also be done. So the total analysis time for this case where there were 6 lanes and 5 moving load cases is about 100 seconds. So in the results, let us first of all check simple deformation. So if we check the combination one, okay, let us deform it. So one of the carriageway is loaded with NC and the other is loaded with NA. So as you can notice, the deformation at the central part for both these carriageways are different. You could change the unit instantly, the deformation should be changed, and this could be shown in fixed format as well. Okay. You can see the values as well if you want to check for a specific part. So if you are zooming in on certain part and you want to check what is the exact deformation at certain node, then that can also be checked. Similarly, you can check bending moments, so forces, beam diagrams, MY, and not the values now. By changing it to kilonewton meter and apply. Okay, so these are my MY in Peer caps, and if we check for NA, so in this case only one carriage way is loaded. We won't be deforming this, and let me just activate the superstructure. So I'll disable the substructure part. Okay, and we'll check for MV max because it's a simply supported structure, so negative moment would be very low. If I check the max moment, so this is the bending moment in one carriage way. Similarly, if I check for combination, which we had done as before, so these are the maximum bending moments due to NA and NC loaded simultaneously. Okay, so you can check reactions, beam bending moments, your stresses, and all of the results are obviously available in tabular format as well. So if I say for beam forces, and if I select any one, so the table would be available, which would be interchangeable with Excel. So you could copy paste the values in Excel at any point of time. Okay. So I hope the demonstration was helpful. If you need any assistance or you want to check out the software, you could write to us on techsupport@midasiit.com and we'll get back to you. If you have any questions, then also you could let us know. Thank you very much for spending time and attending this session. Bye-bye.